Now I want to show you another set of tools. In this case, you're going to run what I consider to be classic overlay analysis. Classic overlay analysis. If we were conducting a music session right now, I'd show you some classic 70s band, okay? So classic overlay. In this case, it's about a double hazard. Here's the problem statement. Like many of you, I don't just teach the tools, right? I use it in the context of some sort of situation, whether it's made up or not. If it's made up, it's always based on a real-world scenario. In this case, hey, the Boulder County Office of Emergency Preparedness has asked you to prepare an assessment of the vulnerable lands in the county to future flooding and the people on those lands. So you're going to consider these layers, and you're going to come up with the places in this particular geographic area that have a double hazard. And in the interest of time, I'm going to actually step you through this in sort of slide form, then I'll illustrate the map. You're going to filter in this case. So it's not in the analysis toolbar, it's actually on the layer. There's a filter button. You're going to filter to only the major floodplains. You're going to do a proximity, a dissolve, a manage data, and then you're going to sort. Okay, so let's go ahead and do that. Okay, so that's our final goal right there. And I've got to sign in here. This will be familiar to many of you. Sometimes your different tabs in the different browsers, they won't recognize you're actually logged into a different account in a different tab or in a different browser. So you'll get used to logging in numerous times. Do a search in ArcGIS Online for Boulder County, Colorado Hazards Analysis Starting Point, like I have here, and then you will start with where exactly I have, where I'm showing you right now. And if I could find the chat box again, it is here. And remember, you can shave off Denver RO maps and replace, if you have any trouble getting into it, replace it with www.arcgis.com/home/webmap, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so here's our starting point. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to filter the geologic hazards. We're going to filter on description is, and look, unique major hazard. Okay, apply filter. So now we only have the major hazards. Again, be critical of the data, click on a couple of these, and you can configure the pop-ups if the pop-ups do not yield exactly what you want, but those are the major hazards. Okay, great. Also, another way to, again, check the data is, okay, I've got just 61 features in here now that are major hazards. Whereas before, if I remove filter and open up the, I had 303 features. So again, just a couple ways to check. I like to do that, as you know, and I would just encourage you to do the same. Or something similar. Use your own way of teaching, of course. So, okay, now I've got the major hazards. Then on the floodplains layer, the whole county is not a floodplain. So again, being critical of the data, this is the way the data is provided from the county GIS portal. The whole county is right here. It's not all floodplain. And so if I look at the layers, I see that there's a field called floodway. And I know this because I've checked the metadata. And so I'm going to filter this one on floodway. This sounds a little bit odd, but in this case, floodway is, and let's look at unique value, floodway. I'm going to filter where floodway is floodway. Okay, so that field where it's populated with the word floodway. So now I'm going to get apply filter, and now I see, oh, okay, this makes more sense. I see the rivers running off of the mountains onto the Great Plains in this case, and I don't have the whole area. Now that I've got those, I want to do an intersection. But before I do that, I'm going to do the following. I'm going to buffer the floodways because, as perhaps some of you have experienced over the last couple decades in your own communities, sometimes the 100 or the 500 year floodplain is, uh-oh, we've exceeded it. So in this case, we actually had some pretty devastating floods in 2013 that went far beyond this area that was designated as floodway here. So that's why I'm going to use the analysis tools, and I'm going to use proximity, and I'm going to create buffers, and I'm going to buffer. Remember the whole wizard-driven nature of these floodplains layer by 200 meters, okay? And as I was indicating earlier, I'm going to say, give it some tags, 200 meters, the GeoEd conference. Remember this use current map extent? Don't want that because maybe I'm not quite zoomed out enough. And then the show credits, 0.2 credits consumed. Okay, no worries. Run analysis. Okay, so now I'm going to buffer my flood planes by 200 meters, make them a little bit wider. I always ask the students, hey, what shape is this going to be if we buffered a point, if you buffered a line, if you buffered a polygon? And get them to vocalize those kinds of geographic patterns, relationships, and trends. They may not have all the vocabulary necessary, but at least they're trying to describe it. Maybe it's a puffy snake or something like that. However they describe it, it's okay because they're thinking about it spatially, and so that's the goal. So I'm going to go to my slides and show you, okay, we have buffered the floodplain, so they're going to be a little bit wider. Let's check and see if it's cranked through. Yep, there it is. Okay, so now we've got a little bit wider than we had before. Again, use the measurement tool, verify that that's 200 meters on each side of those things. Okay, but now we've got a lot of different pieces in here. I don't really want this because, again, thinking about bandwidth and thinking about processing time and so on. So one of the things I can do is actually go under Manage Data and, ooh, Dissolve Boundaries. Dissolve Boundaries. Again, if I didn't know what Dissolve did, I could look at the information buttons, and I'm going to dissolve my buffer of the floodplains, areas that overlapped. I could also use a value, but I'm going to keep it simple here. And I'm not going to create these multi-part. Yeah, I'm going to create these multi-part features. I don't want any statistics. I just want a simple dissolve. And I actually like that name, so I'm going to leave it because it's got my own JJK and my own GeoEd 2020 on there. And I'm not going to use current map extent because I've just zoomed in so you could see this in more detail. Let's go ahead and show credits here. That's 0.25 again. Okay, I'm going to run analysis. That's great. Now, again, thinking about what kinds of questions could you pose to the students? Well, in this case, what's this going to look like if you're truly going to dissolve these interior boundaries? It's going to give me what? What is it going to look like? So once we dissolve this, we're going to be well on our way to our final result. Our end goal is to identify those areas in the county that are in a landslide, major geologic hazard. Usually in this case it's mud flows and landslides, and then also in a flood zone as well. So here is our dissolved. Yep. So we had all these pieces, and now we have the internal boundaries have been dissolved. Okay, so now we can see just in this view right here that this area of the county is in a double hazard. It's in a floodplain, but it also is in this major geologic hazard. So we want to identify all of those things. And so we're going to do analysis one more time. We're going to manage data, and we're actually going to overlay, and we're going to input our dissolved buffer and our geologic hazards. Now notice when we filtered, it didn't make a separate layer. Right? It's operating on the same one, but because it's filtered, it's going to operate kind of like you're used to in the desktop world where you do a selection. It only operates on the selected set. Here, it's only going to operate on the filtered, reduced number of features. Hope that makes sense. So we're going to overlay it on this. We're going to run an intersection, and our result is our intersection. Yeah, that looks good. And I'm not going to save the result in this survey area. I'm actually going to save it in, I should have made a GeoEd folder, shouldn't I have? I'm going to save it in this AAA folder. And I'm not going to use the current map extent because, again, I'm zoomed way in, so I'm going to run the analysis here. But this little polygon, right, should be in our result as one of our doubly hazardous areas. And then after that, in the particular lesson that I've got built around this, I have you do a public relations campaign, and I have you do the following. You enrich the polygons that result, remember the enrichment tool, and I have you search for group quarters, nursing homes, dorms, hospitals, things like that, where multiple people live that maybe, okay, you've only got a certain amount of time and a certain budget for your public relations project. And so you're going to identify those areas with group quarters and in these doubly hazardous zones for your to concentrate your efforts. And so here it is. All right, so I've got that little polygon right there. I can symbolize it differently if I want to. For example, in the lesson, I have you symbolize it in red for like a hatch pattern in there. And here are a couple of other zones around. Okay, so that's the idea, is you enrich then, after you're done with this, you enrich it. Remember that enrichment tool? That's the one that was kind of like the Amazon experience, where you're just grabbing variables and you're putting them in, and it populates your table. It's getting data from the cloud. Maybe I didn't make this as clear as I should have earlier. And based on your location here, and it's going to enrich your data based on these other variables. Oh, it's incredible, incredibly wonderful. All right, so then the result is, as we saw, these little pieces of polygons. Then you sort the polygons by size, and then you do in the enrichment, and then you could figure out what the population is in group quarters. Wonderful. Okay, we better move on. How are you folks doing? Oh my gosh, I wish we had the whole day for this, but I'm really glad you're here. I know there's a lot of good choices here at GeoEd, and again, I wish I was there in the beautiful hills of Kentucky. Now let's concentrate on a couple of other tools that we should have focused on a bit ago, and that is, well, there's an appropriate time for all of these things. And one of them is the crime analysis, because I think it touches on, and you know, there are various versions of this lesson as well, but let's go to Lincoln, Nebraska, out in the Great Plains. I've got some police districts. I've also got some crime incidents, okay, and I can symbolize those. I can look at, I've got the time they occurred, I've got the type of crime, so I can do some temporal and spatial analysis without the analysis tools, for sure. But I also have drive time, so I ran the analysis tools on the drive time from stations, okay, so 5 minutes from each one of these stations. Okay, there are the stations. And so part of my lesson is, what area of Lincoln, in this case, you've got to pick a geographic area, right? You've got to pick an area of interest or where you can get data for. This kind of shattered my image of Lincoln a bit. I've been there a couple times, and I love the University of Nebraska. But it's always, every time I look at crime data, I don't know about you folks, but I'm always like, this has got to be like a five-year time period that I'm looking at. It ends up being like 3 months. And you're just like, oh my goodness, this is depressing, but also this is why we need GIS, right? To get a handle on these vexing, complex issues. So in this case, part of my lesson is, okay, what area is underserved by perhaps a station? And where would you propose to put one based on this? And this is the five-minute drive time from all the stations. Okay. Then, and this is the piece that really focuses on the analysis, the power of the analysis. I can symbolize these crimes, but I want to find out if there's a statistically significant clustering of, in this case, crimes. And so I can run a hotspot analysis on the crimes. Now again, this is a nice way of nudging your students to think about what is significance. Maybe we need to back up. How do we measure significance? Let's back up further. Have they had any stats before? So here I've got, let's turn off the districts, and let's turn on the legend. So once I ran the hotspot analysis, which is one of the analysis tools, now I've got these hotspots with a 99% confidence that this is a statistically clustered zone area of crimes. And conversely, this looks a little better in terms of crimes because it's a cold spot. And we're pretty confident that it's not clustered over there. So maybe we need to look at sort of downtown and just south of the UNL campus for maybe again, I've got this as part of the lesson. Okay, maybe you want to focus there. What's going on there? You know, what are the community attitudes and all kinds of other things that you can incorporate in here. But this doesn't have to be just for crimes, right? This could be lots of other things. It could be the water quality that you've taken with your students, and you've mapped the pH, the dissolved oxygen, the conductivity, et cetera. Where is it significantly, the pH is significantly lower for some reason? Maybe we need to investigate that area of this pond or this river stretch or whatever. Okay, so that is just one more of the analysis tools, okay? And we're steaming toward the end, and I hope that this is intriguing to you all because, oh my gosh, look at all the things that we can actually do here. Now, another one that I love is working with weather data. I know many of you in the geo-environmental world, you love weather climate analysis. And for years, I had a static 2004, it was, weather set of data, point data that I would use. And I still have it. Probably you can relate, many of you, you probably don't ever really get rid of data. You might use it someday. So I have this data set, but then I thought, you know, Joseph, you've got ArcGIS Online and you've got these feeds, these data feeds like I was referring to earlier. Why not use real-time weather for this particular lesson? So, okay, let's do that. And this time I remember to open up in a new tab so I don't have to keep going back to my slides. But the point is, this is global, so it's better than what I had before, and it's real-time. Now, again, there are some issues, right, with bandwidth and so on, but I've got an amazing set of data at my fingertips here. I've got weather buoys, and I also have weather stations on land. Okay, and without burdening you with all of this, I do have this lesson actually as part of the learnarcgis.com gallery of lessons. It's called Predicting the Weather. Okay. Here, let me walk you through what I have you do in this lesson. You look at weather patterns, you predict, you're in germane to our conversation right now, interpolating weather surfaces. Ooh. So you add data, you add some bookmarks, you change the style, so you're looking at pressure, temperature, wind speed. Then you figure out, based on the pressure, where highs and lows are. So you actually add map notes. You put H's and L's on there for highs and lows in certain places around the world. Ooh, a little bit of arcade. Does this look familiar from our earlier discussion? I have you figure out looking at dew point and saturation. And okay, if the temperature is near the dew point, there's probably going to be some saturation and precipitation. I have you round the temperature, so you're building another little expression. And then finally, and most importantly for our conversation here, inside the analytical toolbox is this interpolate points. Now here is where you really have to think about the amount of data that you have at your fingertips here. It's amazing, but it's tens and tens of thousands of points. And so you don't want to run this interpolation on Asia, okay? You want to pick the UK, okay? Switzerland, a state in the US, etc. You have to have a polygon layer, a country's layer, which you can get from the Living Atlas, etc., so that you can use it as like the cookie cutters, right? The cookie cutters that are cut out just pieces so that you can run the interpolation tool on those. So I have you interpolate points based on a state, a country, okay? And then it looks like a map, as you see here on the left, where I have you interpolate temperature. And for example, okay, it's a little cooler up in the Sierra Nevada. So having the students think about proximity to the coast, elevation, the season of the year, the time of day that you're doing it, and so on. Because this is in, you know, real time, basically 10-minute-old data. And so you've got other layers that you have at your fingertips as well, satellite imagery, the precipitation layer, et cetera. Then I have you, in this lesson, interpolate the surface for Algeria. And the reason why is because, as you can see here in the right-hand side, there are several weather stations along the northern part of the country, you know, where most people live. In the southern part of the country, there aren't very many weather stations. It'll interpolate a surface, but then the discussion, and you know what's coming next, can you trust the surface that it generates based on a very few number of points there? Interesting. Similarly, for California, where you've got a lot of stations in California and then in the adjacent state of Nevada, if you interpolated with California and Nevada, it looks different from just the California part for those two states looks different from just California. And the reason why is because if you run it for both states, it's looking at the data on the other side of the border. Whereas if you just do California, it's sort of thinking, I don't know anything beyond the border, so I'm going to do the best I can. Anyway, the results are different, and I want students to think about that. Okay, here is the presentation for that particular map, and I'll just show you that, what it looks like here. Some of you know about this presentation tool, but if not, it is a nice tool. It's a simple tool. It's actually simpler than a story map to create. Story maps I use quite a bit. I'll use them tomorrow for the keynote, unless you're too tired of me by now. Hopefully you'll be back tomorrow. Anyway, but this presentation tool, it gives you a set of slides that are tied to your ArcGIS Online. So it's a nice way of assessing student work, I think. It's saved as part of the web map. It's not a separate item in ArcGIS Online. So it has its advantages. It's also very simple, so there's not a lot you can do with it besides what I'm showing you right now. But here's current conditions. Okay, very good. I'm here in Denver Metro. Very nice. It is, here are the current conditions. It's 9 June and so on. Got a nice cool morning here, as opposed to some of you. Okay. Here's slide 2. I've got a title on there. I've got the base map changed. I've got the wind vectors on there. And so on. Okay, so this is the interpolated surface for Idaho. Remember, the interpolated surface is as the time that you do it. So if you save that, it's going to save it as a layer, but you got to remember to put a date on it somehow, because it doesn't update as the weather data updates. So that's another important thing. When you run these analyses, sometimes, okay, it's going to be maybe real-time data that's streaming in, but the thing that you're producing, either an interpolated surface or maybe the hotspot analysis, is static. So it's important to, I think, touch on that as you go forward. So this is the lesson, predicting the weather, and I invite you to do that. Now, in our remaining minutes, this is really, really powerful. Oh, you folks are so nice. When I start singing, then people will leave in droves. No, I won't do that. But this notion here, if you join, I've got a lesson on this. It's just a short essay on this. Let's say you've got some point data on the left side, like this. I've got agricultural land by country, the amount of agricultural land in each country according to a certain data set. And you want to make a choropleth map out of that. Well, there is some of you, I think probably all of you are aware that, okay, I know about join data, Joseph. I've got, you know, two geodatabases and I've got their tables and I'm going to join attributes, or I'm going to do a spatial join where I'm going to get the number of something inside something else. Well, now, since you've got this cloud-based set of tools, you can join two data that's in ArcGIS Online, Living Atlas, and other sources. That is kind of a mind-boggling paradigm shift, because to me it's kind of like Enrich. We ran the Enrich tool and we grabbed data from the cloud based on your location. Here it's similar, but here you're joining your data. You can do an attribute or a spatial join to ArcGIS Online. And so now I can map the ag land by country, because I've joined to a generalized world country layer, and I've got more details in that that essay. That is wonderful, because a lot of times we don't want the point data. Yeah, I can symbolize them in different colors and different sizes, but I really want to make a choropleth map. Ooh, there's teachable moments there too, right? Because, okay, X percent of X country is agricultural, but that doesn't mean it's uniform across the country, right? There's not 30% of Nunavut is agriculture as opposed to 30% of southern Saskatchewan. Anyway, powerful that we can do that. I wanted to show you, I'll touch on this tomorrow, based on our notion of tools are changing. The new online map viewer, some of you may have seen this. This is what ArcGIS Online is going to look like probably after the end of the year. You can look at it in beta right now. You're going to have some tools on the left. These look familiar, right? Layers, base map, et cetera, add data. And you're going to have some things on the right that you can do, filter, et cetera. I don't know where the analysis tools are going to be, but they probably will not be at the top, like in the map viewer that we have right now. They're probably going to be on the right side. No worries, though. They'll be there at some point, and you'll be able to do this in this new map viewer. Why new map viewer? A couple reasons. It's going to be faster. It's built on a newer architecture. You're going to be able to do more powerful things with it that I think you'll enjoy. Anyway, I want to show you that. If you haven't had a chance to look at it, you might want to do that. Last, final words. You can create, because this is all part of this whole platform, web mapping applications from every single thing that we did, from the crime analysis to the zebra mussels to the trace downstream. You can create story maps, web app builder maps, compare apps. You can also, number two, bring the results into ArcGIS Pro, into Insights, into Business Analyst Web. So you're looking at consumer behavior and who bought lottery tickets and who bicycles to work and all kinds of information in there for further analysis. In other words, yes, start with these 40-ish tools. But if you want to dig deeper, if you have time in your curriculum, there's no preventing you from doing exactly that. Okay? So I think that's really powerful. Keep learning. I've mentioned the Learn libraries. There's level 2 geo inquiries that lets you do some of the analysis tools as well. So pay attention to those. Even if you're not teaching primary and secondary, universities can use those level 2s and those Learn lessons as well. Take a look at a middle school student that actually used some analysis to figure out Legionnaires' disease in a community in Minnesota. So good things that students can do with this. The spatial analysis posters that I referred to earlier, and then that education blog that I was referring to numerous times. Okay, let's go back to the very beginning. Questions, comments, issues? I know we've got another thing to attend here shortly, but I know that was a lot, but hopefully that was, I can do this. They're straightforward. I can get help if I need to. The presentation tool, yes. Inside, let me find a tab where I'm actually logged in. Okay, so let's say I'm in this weather lesson that I was talking about. Okay, I can create a presentation. I already have one in this one, so I'm going to edit it. But if I didn't, it would say create presentation in the upper right if I'm signed in. So it would say create presentation. You would create the presentation, add your 3 or 4 slides or whatever you want. And you can also use it as an assessment tool, as I was mentioning earlier, and as a nice presentation tool in an online environment or face-to-face. So yep, thanks for the note, Rodney, about the survey. I do appreciate everybody's attention, and map on. I salute all of you working in these disruptive educational and societal times. So you're making a positive difference in our world. Keep it up. Keep up the good work. And we'll talk to you in another session, maybe tonight at the open house. All right, talk to you folks later. Take care.
Thank you, Joseph, and thank you everyone for attending this wonderful presentation. A lot of tools, a lot of information, a lot of resources that Joseph has given to you, so please make use of those. I had no idea how powerful ArcGIS Online truly was. Thank you again.
Oh, my pleasure.
Joseph, you see the chat about the slide presentation?
Yes. Let me pull that up. Yeah, it's an attachment on this essay.
I don't know if I don't know if they're cataloging all the presentations or not. I'll have to check with Vince or Nicole about that. But we have the location if you want to go to it, save it. I know for normally in-person conferences we would always capture the presentations and then send them out in a bulk email, but I'd assume the same thing here.
Yeah, no problem. Happy to do it.